no one had ever even done a test of any type on digital signals in terms of that SAR. So that he said, you know, what can we do to push this forward? And my response to that was, we have to do an awful lot of science to see whether or not that SAR is even relevant to these digital signals. And this was another one of those times when, you know, he said, well, thanks a lot for stopping by.
we'll take that under
consideration. And we'll take
it
from there.
You
know, we'll get back to you. So what ended up happening was is that through political pressure, the 1.6 watts per kilogram standard was actually adopted as a guideline by the FCC.
Okay.
Before the 1.6 watts per kilogram was adopted for analog signals.
That's kind of backwards.
It was backwards completely. And there was almost no science to support that 1.6 with digital signals, but it was to facilitate the auction.
Okay.
So here's what happened. So now you have this great auction happening.
Okay.
And a number of entrepreneurs who had gotten rich in the dot-com boom.
Ah. Kind of mavericks.
And mavericks had a lot of money to throw around, and they got involved in the auction. And the auction went crazy. It got up into the billions and billions of dollars.
Unbelievable.
So now you have the end of the auction, and you have these people now looking at each other saying, you know, I don't really have all the money to pay the FCC.
Yeah, I run into this problem myself on certain purchases.
So they went to the FCC, and they said, well, you know, let's make a deal. So the FCC, who is responsible for regulating the development of the infrastructure for this PCS signaling, or this digital signaling, made a deal that said you can put 10% down and you can pay us the other 90% after you're out there operating, collecting fees from people.
Oh, my God. And that 90% would represent how much money are we talking here?
Oh, billions of dollars.
Okay, so now billions of dollars are owed to the, what, U.S. Treasury?
Owed to the U.S. Treasury under the auspices of the FCC. So now the FCC, the Federal Communications Commission, is the mortgagor for this industry. So that type of conflict
of interest,
was there all through the years when this technology was being deployed. That's why now you see these problems where citizens are standing up saying, you know, we don't want that base station on the school. We don't want that base station on the fire station. And the reason that that's there is because the FCC bent over backwards to give these companies the ability to deploy the new infrastructure as quickly as possible so the FCC could get their money. So we now have the residual of that happening now. Now, the FCC is a different kind of agency because it's a commission-based agency. And it's not a safety agency, but everybody points to this 1.6 watts per kilogram standard as a safety standard. It is not a safety standard. The FCC does not have the authority to issue a safety standard. So this is another one of those bait and switch obfuscation approaches that the industry has been using. So that what happens is that the industry says, we meet all of the applicable safety standards, forgetting to tell the public that there are no applicable safety standards.
I see. What's happened in here to the Environmental Protection Agency? Don't they regulate radiation from bases?
Well, it's an interesting problem with the Environmental Protection Agency, because the Environmental Protection Agency was the most aggressive government agency in terms of controlling radio frequency radiation emissions, the most aggressive. And when you look at the three agencies who are possibly responsible for cell phone regulation and the safety cell phone for cell phone users, you have the FDA, the FCC, and the EPA. Among the three, the EPA was the most aggressive. And if the EPA were involved in the regulatory process, you have to follow a very stringent standard called the National Environmental Policy Act standard. Very stringent, and the cell phone industry would never be able to meet the standards under NEPA. So what happened to the EPA? Through political pressure, their budget was cut down to nothing. So now, as we sit today, 2006, there is only one person at the Environmental Protection Agency who is addressing radio frequency radiation, and he is not able to speak publicly about the issue.
This is just hard to comprehend, Dr. Carlo. I'm just trying to understand what you're saying. We have this multi-billion dollar industry affecting how many people now use cell phones today?
1.6 billion around the world.
Around the world. Lots and lots of people. And here in the United States, we have one person sitting at the EPA who's responsible for regulating, you might say, or warning us, and this person is gagged in some way?
That's correct. He is not able to speak publicly. I spoke to him about 2 months ago, and we had a great chat, and he said, of course, can't repeat any of this.
Uh-huh. Oh.
Now, so the EPA is sort of handled that way.
Uh-huh.
Now, the FDA, even in view of our findings showing problems and subsequent findings now out of Europe confirming everything that we found.
Including the mechanisms?
Including the mechanisms. Actually, taking it a step further, let's talk about that a little bit. Because after we came out with our findings in 1999, the Canadian government did an interesting thing. They put together a review panel hastily, Health Protection Branch in Canada, to review all the available evidence with regard to cell phone dangers, but only evidence that had been published. So that when they put this together, our studies had not been published yet. So that our studies were excluded. So the Health Protection Branch in Canada gave an advisory to Canadian citizens saying everything's fine. Because it was based on the data from the 1990s.
Okay.
The European Union did it a little bit differently. In the United Kingdom, there was a commission put in place by Parliament under Sir William Stewart. It's called the Stewart Commission.
Uh-huh.
And they reviewed all the same data that the Canadians reviewed.
Uh-huh.
But they came out and said, you know, there are some real serious questions here, and we're going to recommend that children not use cell phones until we sort some of this out.
Good.
And there needs to be more research. So the European Union put 8 million euro, which is about $12 million, into a follow-on research program, picking up where we left off. In the end of 2004, those results were released. They confirmed leakage of the blood-brain barrier, formation of micronuclei.
They confirmed your
findings. They confirmed our findings, but they also went further. They said that the genetic damage caused altered gene expression. So it actually altered the way genes were expressed, and part of that altered gene expression was cell proliferation. So that the new data shows that not only do we have genetic damage, but the genetic damage affects genes, and the way it affects genes is cell proliferation, which is the development of cells that are uncontrollably growing, which in medical textbooks, the definition of cancer.